Hello and welcome to the K-12 online conference. My name is David Warlick and I have been asked to deliver the keynote address for this conference. And I don't look the way that I usually do when I'm delivering a keynote address because you're seeing me the way I usually look when I'm writing my blogs, just in case you read my blog entries. It's very early in the morning. Rasta in the next room is asleep on the bed. That's Rasta the dog. Brenda's upstairs. I assume she's still asleep. It's very early in the morning, so I'm speaking kind of quietly. But I am in my position this time of the day, writing my blog. See, there I am, writing my blog. And I'm going to be spending the day delivering this keynote address. Now, I am here, and I am now. But that's not important because you are there and you are then, and I don't know where you are. I don't know when you are. You could be in your classroom where you have access to broadband. You could be at home. You know, you could be working on lesson plans. You could be in your car listening to this as a podcast while you're driving down the road. It could be next week. It could be next month. It could be next year. It doesn't really matter because information just does not travel in a straight row anymore. And that's sort of going to be the theme of my keynote address, and I think of this conference, that information just is simply fallen apart, and it is moving in directions that we could not have imagined only a few years ago. And the thing is, if we understand how this information has changed, if we understand how information has reshaped and is reshaping itself, and that we do have some control over how that information works, then we can use this new information landscape, which our students, many of our students, understand. We can use this new information landscape to produce brand new and powerful learning experiences for our students. So I'm going to be carrying my iPod with my iTalk and my camera around with me today. And as ideas occur to me that I think might be useful to you, I'll sit in front of the camera and I'll talk. So enjoy. Hello, I'm out and about now, and I'm sitting here in the parking lot in front of Starbucks. That's Starbucks coffee. That's where I do the writing for my books and most of the magazine articles that I write. I find that it's important to get away from email and the internet and things like that, the distractions of the house. And I can sit in there, I can have my coffee, thanks to the users of Classroom Blogmaster, which of course is a free service. It's a free blogging tool for classrooms. But many of the users of it have helped me out by donating to my Starbucks card. So when I go into Starbucks to do some writing, I just hand them my card, and there's almost always some money on there, and it's fueling my writing. So I get my coffee, and I go sit at a table, and I bring out my laptop, and I can start writing. And there's just something about the murmur of the conversations around me that forced me to focus on the writing. Sometimes I've got to resort to putting my iPod earbuds in, but most of the time it's the murmur that helps me write. Now, I have my mobile phone. I have one of those Motorola Q mobile phones, which gives me good access to email and to the web. It's not as convenient as the computer, but when I do need to check my email, when I do need to look up something on the internet, the phone gives me access. And in essence, that little round table in Starbucks becomes the global offices of the Landmark Project, where I can maintain certain parts of my website. I mean, this amazes me. I grew up in the 1950s and 60s, and the idea of sitting at this table and having access to the world and writing books that will soon be available to people around the world just absolutely floors me sometimes. But at the same time, I have to admit that I am on the other side of middle age. I've been around for a long time, and I'm old-fashioned about a lot of things. I have romantic notions of what it is to be a teacher. I have romantic notions of what it is to work with educators, to teach educators about this new information environment, how to integrate it into their teaching, into their students' learning.
I believe in the high tech. At the same time, I'm a pretty direct tech person. I like the direct touch. I want to, you know, I believe in the electricity that crosses between eye contact when you're actually talking to somebody face to face. And that served us very well for a long time. But we live in a different time today, folks. We live in a time of rapid change. We live in an entirely new and dynamic information landscape that our students take for granted, and they are in a different generation. Most of the kids in our classrooms today have absolutely no conscious recollection of the 20th century, the century that raised us. For many of them, the only connection that they have with the previous, with the last century, is happening in their classrooms, where they're supposed to be learning about their future. They're supposed to be prepared for their future. And ladies and gentlemen, the only way that we are going to be able to adequately teach our children within a context that is meaningful to them and to their future is if we are connected to this high tech, as if we are connected to each other through these new avenues and these new languages that we can speak. Certainly our children are natives and we are immigrants. But it is time for us to stop acting like immigrants and start acting like natives, or else we're going to miss, we're going to lose our children. Well, I'm at the Raleigh train station right now. Let me just show you. There's the station. There are the rails headed south. Here are the rails headed north. Coincidentally, Brenda and I will be here in a couple of weeks, where we're going to get on the train here and we're going to head north to New York City, where I'll be speaking at a conference in Manhattan. We'll spend the weekend with my youngest brother, who lives there in Manhattan. And then on Monday, I'll get on another train and I'll head west into Connecticut, where I'll be speaking at a conference in Hartford. My wife will head back down south again. We're going to ride this train. It'll be several hours. We'll be facing in the same direction. We'll be headed in the same direction. It's how you ride the train. Train can only go one way at once, and it pretty much stays on the rail. Now, in what ways does this act as a metaphor for traditional conferences that we attend? If you were coming into my keynote address at a traditional conference, say the conference in Connecticut, everybody would walk into the room, they would walk down the aisles, they would sit in their chairs, and they would all face the same direction toward me, where they're listening to me. Up on the stage, this one time, this one place, all the attention is going in one direction. When the keynote address is over, people are going to walk out of the main auditorium, and they're going to go to presentation rooms, and they're going to go in various directions, but there's still a rail there that everyone is riding on from session to session, from period to period, through the calendar, through the schedule, through the program of the conference. This conference is different. This conference is different from any conference you've ever attended because there is no rail. Think of our students. Think of our schools. How much are they on the rail? How much are our children sitting in a train on the rail, on the standards, learning the same things, learning the same way, all facing the same direction? Your first graders are facing toward the second grade. Second graders are facing toward the third grade. And they're all facing the same direction. They're all learning the same things. They're all being taught to think the same way so that they can all go forward to graduation. And it is necessary to have that rail. It is necessary to have standards. It is necessary for all of us to have a common context within which to live in order to be part of the culture. But we know that when our children leave school in the afternoon, we know that they continue to learn. We know that they continue to learn important things about problem solving, about their world. And they learn these things by leaving the rail behind. They learn these things by going home and with their mobile phones and their text messaging and their IMing on their computers and the blogs that they're creating and MySpace and their video games that are connected to other players around the world. We know that they're learning in these experiences, but they're learning by taking side trips. They're leaving the rails behind and they're taking side trips. And this is what we're doing in this conference. There is a program in a sense. There is a list of presenters in a sense. But the biggest part of this conference is going to be something that's happening independent of a place or a time. It's going to continue to be out there for a long time, way beyond the 4 weeks of this conference. And it's going to be more than just the presenters presenting their ideas. It's going to be a conversation. I'm going to throw some stuff out there about these conferences, but I'm hoping that that conversation is going to continue as we all share ideas, as we all grow on each other's ideas, as we blog, as we tag our blogs, as we aggregate these conversations together in ways that help us to learn, in ways that help us to see things in new ways and to build knowledge and then to share that knowledge with other people. I'm not even sure I would call it a conference. I don't know what to call it. But this experience is going to be entirely different. It's going to be like something that most of us have never experienced before. And at the same time, it's going to be something that a lot of us are already doing every single day. I have to say that the last 2 years have been the most intense learning experience of my life. It has been a day-by-day, week-by-week conference that I have been engaged in with people out there who have things to say that help me do my job, have things to say that are valuable to me in terms of the goals that I'm trying to achieve, the problems that I'm trying to solve. And by being engaged in that conversation, which is exactly what this conference is going to be about, then we're all going to learn, and we're going to learn by teaching each other. And that is 21st century learning right there. Is when we start learning by teaching each other, by learning from each other's experience and knowledge. Uneasy seat that I'm sitting on here, and I'm in the Raleigh Greenway, part of the Raleigh Greenway, which goes all over the city. And here come some people with dogs. Y'all, excuse. That's kind of weird. I was driving over to the university, and I decided to take a little shortcut. Actually, I decided to take a side trip. I was driving along and drove down this road. Shelley Lake Road was the name of it, and I pulled off on the side of the road and got on the Greenway and decided to take a little walk along the Greenway, which y'all just experienced. See, that's the difference between being on the rail and being able, you know, being in control of your experience, being able to navigate your own way, which is what I have done. I've navigated down to this place that could never be reached by the rail. Now, certainly we need the rail. Certainly we need that curriculum. We need a set of skills, and we need a set of knowledge that all children need to have, that all of us need to have in order to be a culture. We've got to have a context for the culture that we live in. But I don't think that that rail, I don't think that that one single curriculum needs to be the central part of what we are teaching and learning. Howdy.
Good morning.
There went another dog. Where was I? The rail is not the central part. It's not the foundation of what kids need to be learning today. The foundation of what kids need to be learning should be those side trips. It should be the Greenway. It should be the trees that we can go see and the desert that we can go visit. It should be the choices that we make as individuals of what we want to learn, what we want to make ourselves an expert at. Because, ladies and gentlemen, that's the very best thing that we can be teaching our children today, is how to teach themselves, how to make themselves experts. Thomas Friedman says in his book that the four types of people who will prosper, in the flat world will people who are special, and I don't know anybody who's special. This is Michael Jordan. You know, these are people who are going to make it no matter where they are. And people who are specialized, people who can who are adaptable, and people who are anchored, people who are special, you know, Michael Jordan, people who are anchored are people who can make a living by touching you or something that you own. This is your barber. This is your the chef of your restaurant. You know, they have to be there in order to make their living. But it's the other two that are going to generate the economy that supports people who are special and people who are anchored. It's people who are specialized, people who can make themselves an expert, people who know something or can do something that nobody else can do. These are people who can make themselves an expert. People who are highly adaptable are people who can learn and unlearn and relearn very easily. These are the kinds of people who need to be coming out of our classrooms, people who know how to make themselves an expert and people who can learn and unlearn and relearn very easily. This is why the central part, this is why the foundation of education system today should not be the rail, but it should be the side trips. It should not be the central standard curriculum, but it should be those directions that students, that learners, both teachers and students, can navigate to on their own. We have the ability to do that today. Many, many years ago, when I had just moved here to Raleigh, I had just joined the North Carolina State Department of Public Instruction. This was 1990. And in 1990, I was one of only two or three people in the whole department who had access to the internet. Now, there were a number of us who were emailing in and out of the internet through something called Fredmail, but I was one of only a couple of people who could actually surf the internet. Now, you got to understand that in 1990, surfing the internet was way different from what it is today. Back in 1990, you couldn't point and click. Back in 1990, you didn't point and click your way around on the internet. It was like DOS. You had to type in these secret incantations into the computer in order to get to the places that you wanted to go. But that was cool because we could get there. We could navigate there. You just had to know the language. Well, one day, I got an email message. It was a mailing list message, a listserv message. Lots of people got copies of it. And it was announcing a new service on the internet called IRC. Now, IRC stood for something called Internet Relay Chat. Now today they call it chat rooms, today they call it instant messenger, where you could sit at the computer, you could type a message in, and other people could read your message as you were typing it in. Back then, the email was announcing the first IRC server, which was at North Carolina State University, right up the road from where I live here in Raleigh. And I figured that night, I'm going to give this thing a try, I'm going to give this new idea a try. So got home that evening, helped get the kids to bed, went and connected to the internet, logged into this IRC server over at North Carolina State University, and it gave me a list of channels. Channel A, Channel B, Channel C. And you know, the metaphor there was TV. You're going into these different TV channels where you could talk to people. I chose Channel C because it had four people in it. And I wanted to get into a channel that already had a lot of people because they were already talking. If I went into a channel which is one or two people, I'd be expected to start talking, to start chatting. And I wasn't ready to chat. I wanted to lurk a little bit. So I went into Channel C, four people. And immediately, these messages started scrolling up the screen, these people talking to each other. And I typed in hi, and they all typed in hi, and then continued on with their conversation. Now, I very quickly realized that these were computer science students. Which made sense, because North Carolina State University is our computer science engineering school here in the state. And they were talking about this exam that they had just taken, and they weren't being at all polite about it. So I finally broke in. I listened to the conversation, and I finally broke in, and I introduced myself, told them what I do for a living, and they very politely faked an interest in what I do for a living. And then I asked, what do you believe, fifth graders, could do with this level of access to the internet? Well, there was a long cyber pause, because back in 1990, nobody was thinking about fifth graders on the internet. You know, it was still the domain of big universities and research centers and the government, the military. Nobody was thinking about K-12 kids on the internet. But after a minute, somebody said, well, you know, you can go to NASA now and you can get lists of the shuttle missions and their manifests and descriptions of their upcoming missions. And then somebody said, well, there's this place over at the University of Washington where you can type in a command, a finger command, and you can get a list of all the earthquakes that have happened around the world in the last 2 weeks with the longitudinal and latitudinal coordinates. And then somebody else said, well, you know, if you can do that, you can go over here and you can do this with it. And they were starting to get really excited, because you can tell when computer nerds are getting excited, because their spelling improves. And finally, somebody said, you know, this is so exciting. This is so interesting. Let's get together in real time and let's talk about it. And I said, fine, where do you want to meet? And they gave me the name of the pizza joint. And you know, I didn't recognize it because I'd only lived in Raleigh for a couple of months. So I asked them for the address. They gave me the address. I figured it was one of those places close to the university, but I didn't recognize the street. So I finally typed in, where are you guys anyway? And they typed back, well, Reykjavik, Iceland. I had to type back, well, I've got to take a rain check because I'm in Raleigh, North Carolina, USA, and I won't be able to make it. Y'all forgive me.
I'm nosy.
I'm delivering a keynote address to a group of educators all over the world.
Well, we should listen to this.
Oh, it's almost done. Yeah, I'm almost done. I'm doing part of it here. I'm doing part of it at the train station. I'm doing some of it in my backyard. And I'll put it out on the internet, and educators all over the world will be watching and learning.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, that's wonderful.
It's great fun.
Well, we were afraid we'd interrupt because it looked like you were filming.
I was just finishing up with the bot, I finished it. Yeah, I sort of interrupted when I was out on the Greenway telling the story about the pizza order. And I thought I would finish it up here. I mean, you got the pretty much the whole story, but not necessarily the moral of the story. And the moral didn't occur to me until about 2 weeks after I had had this online IRC encounter with the students in Iceland. And, you know, the thing is, after this event, after this took place, you know, I patted myself on the shoulder. This was great. I had talked with educators, or excuse me, I had talked with people in another country for free. I'd talked to people a quarter of the way around the planet for free. And at this time, in 1990, it cost dollars just to make a long-distance call across the state, you know, just a short long-distance call across the state. And the idea of calling beyond the borders of my country for free just completely floored me. But it was about 2 weeks after this that I really got to thinking about the experience. And I realized that it wasn't that I was talking to these people for free that made it such an important experience, is that I talked with them for about 40 minutes before I knew that they were from another country. For 40 minutes, it didn't matter that we were a quarter of a planet apart from each other. For 40 minutes, it didn't matter that we spoke different native languages. It didn't matter that we came from different cultures. We were people who were communicating with each other through a new avenue of communication, and we were sharing our ideas, and we were sharing our insights, and we were teaching each other. And this is a model. I realized then that this is a model for the kind of world that our students are going to be taking for granted. And of course, much of this has already happened. Our kids spend every day online with people across the street and people around the world, and they're learning from these engagements. They're learning from these encounters that they're having with people within the context of mere conversations, within the context of games that they play. And I think that this is, it's not in a world where geography does not mean what it did in 1990, where the balance between geography and talent is now tilting toward talent. In that world, learning becomes much more than simply sitting in a classroom or sitting in a conference room and listening to somebody talk to you. It means being engaged in conversation. It means sharing. It means observing your experience, reflecting on that experience, sharing it with other people, and then engaging in conversations. And that's what this conference is about. You know, learning today is work. It's not passively sitting back and paying attention. Learning today is work, and we're going to ask you to work. We're going to ask you to do more than just simply watch me and listen to me and watch the other presenters and listen to them and read what they have to say. We want you to engage. We want you to blog. We want you to actively bring content together in ways that are personally meaningful to you, and we're going to ask you to contribute to this conference and contribute to other people, and I'm getting ready to explain to you some ways that you can do that. So walk with me back to my office and I'm going to show you a few little tricks. Later on this week, I will be speaking at the South Carolina EdTech Conference. Now, this is going to be a real treat for me because South Carolina is a neighbor, and also because South Carolina is where I did all of my teaching back in the 1970s and early 1980s. I have no aspirations of any of my old friends being there because, quite frankly, most of the people, all of the people that I taught with are now long retired. So, I'm not expecting to see any old friends, but it's still symbolically important to be returning back home to speak at this conference. And in thinking about this upcoming event, I got to thinking about some of my earliest experiences with technology, and I want to tell you one quick story here that I think pertains in a way to what this conference is all about. And I'm going to go all the way back to 1981, the first time that I saw a personal computer. Now, at that time, I had no idea what a computer would do. I had seen pictures of them in Radio Shack catalogs, but I had absolutely no idea of what computers did, what personal computers did. I'd seen mainframe computers, and I'd seen all the lights flashing and the Hollerith punch cards and the tape whirring around. I mean, this is what computers did. This was my idea of what computers did. Well, I was taking a course at Wingate College, and the professor had a learning lab in Monroe. And for one of the class periods, he invited us all to his learning lab to take us on a tour and show us the diagnostic and prescriptive tools that he used in his business in order to diagnose learning disabilities and to help students become better readers. So we all met there. He took us on a tour, and when I first walked into the room, I saw this computer sitting on a table over at the corner. It was a Radio Shack Model 1 computer. So I followed the professor around, Dr. Funderburk, and he showed us the different programs that he had and the different paper-based tools, nothing about the computer, but just the different things that he had to help his clients. And at the end of the tour, he dismissed us, and I interrupted him. I said, Dr. Funderburk, what about that computer over there in the corner? How do you use that? And he looked over there and he says, oh, I'm glad you mentioned that. Let's take a look at this computer. So he took the class over there and he sat me down at this computer, at this Radio Shack Model 1 computer. He reached over and he turned it on. Now, I had no idea what to expect from this. For all I knew, he was going to turn it on and lights would start flashing on the screen. That's about what I expected. But he reached over and he turned it on, and in the upper right-hand corner of that screen, it said, ready. Now, I literally fell out of my chair because we had a machine. We have a machine here that is talking to me. It's telling me that it's ready. Then he reached over and he went to the keyboard and he typed in, load math program from tape. Well, there was a little cassette drive over to the right and it started running. And about 4 minutes later, text appeared on the screen, a list of options. You know, it said math programs, addition, subtraction, multiplication, long division, and then down beneath that it said, press the number of the type of program that you want to run. The machine was telling me how to operate it. Well, I reached up and I hit the number 4 for long division. And it put a long division problem up on the screen for me and it explained to me how to answer it. So I started typing in the answers and I finally got to the right answer. And for about a minute and a half, pixel by pixel, it made a picture of a smiling face congratulating me on my good work. Then it gave me another problem. And that time, I typed in the wrong answer. For about a minute and a half, pixel by pixel, it made a picture of a frowning face, signaling that I'd gotten the wrong answer. Now, it was like, you know, they say, when you're about to die, your life flashes before your eyes. This is what I felt like. I felt like my life was flashing before my eyes because I was sitting here looking at a technology that you operate by communicating with it. You operate this machine by communicating with the machine. Now, I had always taught history from the perspective of technology. I didn't know it at the time, but I'd always taught history from the perspective of technology. I'd taught that when we invented agriculture, it affected culture in these ways. When we invented the bow and arrow, it affected culture in these ways. When we invented the steam engine, it affected culture in these ways. And when I saw this computer, this Radio Shack Model 1 computer that I could operate by talking to the machine, by communicating with it, I saw this as one of those technologies that's going to change everything. We invented the personal computer and it affected our culture in these ways, and I was seduced. Well, the next year, my middle school that I taught in won a grant. It was one of two middle schools in the district that won a grant to put 11 Radio Shack Model 3 computers in our school. Model 3, 16 kilobytes of memory. These things were hot. And since none of the other teachers in my school had any interest in them, I got all 11 in my classroom. 1982, I had an 11 computer lab in my classroom. Now, there was a problem. Problem was, we had no software. There was no appropriation of money for software. Back then, we thought that just the green glow of the cathode ray tubes washing over our children's faces would make them smarter. So, with no software, I had to teach myself how to program. I taught myself basic programming, and I started writing instructional programs for my students. One of the programs that I wrote was called Stock Baron, and it was essentially a stock market simulation where the student came to the computer, they typed in N for the next month, and it gave them $100,000 make-believe dollars and five companies that they had an option to buy stock in. They would get an online newsletter called the Wall Street Review. And this online newsletter included three stories, which I had planted. And these three stories were designed to have either a positive or a negative effect on one of the companies that they had an option to buy stock in. So they would read the stories, decide what companies might be hurt by this event, what companies might be helped by this event, and then they would sell and buy stock accordingly. And they would play this for 6 months, trying to make as much money as they could. Now, this went fine for about a week. But after a week, there was a group of boys who called themselves the Stock Barons. And these boys were suddenly making millions and millions and millions of dollars in 1 6-month period. And I would get on at the end of the day and play the game, and the most I could make was $500,000, $500,000. I knew the codes. I wrote the stories. I should be getting a perfect score, and the most I could make was $500,000. These kids are making millions. So I asked them, how did you do this? How are you making all of this money? And they just said, oh, Mr. Warlick, it's just shrewd business finance knowledge. We know we have what it takes. So this went on for a couple of weeks. These kids were making millions of dollars. Finally, after a couple of weeks, one of the boys waited until after school, waited until the halls were cleared, and he came into my classroom. And he said, Mr. Warlick, I need to explain to you how we're making all that money. He said, we discovered a bug in your program. I taught him what a bug was. He said, we discovered a bug in your program. We discovered that under these conditions, we can actually sell more stock than we own. Well, that night, I took one of the computers home with me. And I worked on the code a little bit. Then I brought the computer in the next morning and I loaded the program onto the other computers. And I waited. First period comes along, my social studies students come in, I'm lecturing, and after a minute, study hall kids come in for computer. Stock barons are coming in. And the stock barons walk in, and I remember one particular stock baron by the name of Pearson Duval. Pearson Duval comes strutting into the classroom, and he goes and he sits at his favorite computer, and he starts typing. And I keep an eye on Pearson Duvall. While I'm lecturing, I keep an eye on Pearson Duvall. And after a minute, that cocky look on Pearson's face turns into concern. And a couple of moments later, that concern turns into downright worry. Finally, Pearson Duvall hesitantly raises his hand and says, "Mr. Warlick, what does embezzlement mean?" I had Pearson Duvall. I had gotten Pearson Duvall, and I will never forget that. Never forget that moment. But you know, I learned something that day. I learned that what was special about this new technology was not that it's a machine that you operate by communicating with it. What's really special is that it's a machine through which we can communicate with each other in brand new and powerful ways. And that's what this conference is about. It's about an event where we are going to learn by communicating with each other in powerful new ways. And I think if we all do our jobs as 21st century learners, then we're going to learn a lot from each other. Y'all have a great conference.
Protected under an attribution, non-commercial, share-alike, creative commons license.